It's past the appointed time and we have a quorum. I call the meeting to order. This is the 12th meeting of the Bills Committee meeting on Stamp Duty Amendment Bill 2013. Item number one, we will continue our meeting with the administration. Could you please invite the administration to join us? In accordance with a past practice, I first declare that I own properties. I am an accountant by profession. The company I work for, provide advice on properties, including the content of the bill, but I'm not part of such service. Mr. Tony Tse, I declare what I declared in the past. Mr. Kenneth Leung, I own properties and I engage in tax services, including stamp duty. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong, I declare what I have declared before. Mr. Lau Chi Chang, I have properties in Hong Kong. The administration has provided us with a response paper. One to respond to Mr. To's written submission, and the other one to matters raised at the meeting. In the meeting held on the 14th and 28th of March, they are CB bracket 11219 stroke 13-14 bracket 03. That is the response to Mr. To's submission, and the other one being CB bracket 11219 stroke 13-14 bracket 02. Since Mr. To's not here, perhaps we will first go over paper number CB bracket 11219 stroke 13-14 bracket 02. That is the response to matters raised at the meetings on the 14th and the 28th of March 2014. These matters include consider exempting the car parking space from the double ad valorem stamp duty, the double stamp duty, or well, members asked for the ad valorem duty of the old scale is to be adopted. Well, since it's quite some time since the last meeting, perhaps you can go over the points with us. PS, DS. I know that we're all very busy, and the scrutiny of the bill is going at full steam. We've started clause by clause. We've gone over a number of clauses touching on the ad valorem stamp duty system, the principles and arrangements of the collection of the duty, and how we assess and calculate the stamp duty payable if the transaction involves both a residential and non-residential property, and exemption arrangements involving closely related persons, residential and non-residential properties, and other matters. I will go over the salient points of the factors we have considered. The stamp duty at double the rate will be levied on properties. We consider that there is a housing need for Hong Kong PR permanent residents who don't have another property. We will provide exemptions. And if more than one person is involved, there may be non-Hong Kong PR being a closely related person, and we need to provide exemptions. Given this general example, this general principle, the stamp duty is basically an ad valorem duty charge on an instrument basis. If the instrument involves more than one property, we will take into consideration the total consideration when working out the rate to be applied. And that is the overall principle. Under the DSD, double stamp duty, this arrangement is also adopted. When we deal with the DSD, we have designed different exemptions to applicable to different scenarios. And that depends on the nature of the property, whether it is residential or non-residential. Say, for example, so when we consider exemptions, we will consider whether the property is separable and independent. Say, for example, well, whether it's the title is to be owned on its separately, and whether it can be split and sold. If they can be split and sold, then we will consider suitable exemptions or refund as appropriate. When we assess the tax span or tax rate, we consider the total consideration of the instrument. We also need to decide the nature of residential and non-residential property. You find the definition under Section 29A bracket 1. There are four common categories of instruments. Say, for example, government lease, occupation permit, deed of mutual covenant. We will look at the conditions under the instrument to see if it can be used as partly, wholly as a residential. If that is prohibited under the stamp duty ordinance, it will be considered non-residential. If it is not non-residential, it is residential. Under the ad valorem stamp duty regime, we look at the instrument. If it involves a parking space and a residential property, if it's under the same title deed and not separable, in general, we will consider that as a part ancillary to the residential property, and the stamp duty will be charged accordingly. Last time, we also discussed about arrangements relating to closely related persons. We have set out different examples and possible scenarios. They are set out in the annex of the paper. It is our policy intent to regulate people who already own a property. Double stamp duty will be charged. If the buyer already owns a property at the time of acquisition, and if they are Hong Kong PR and buying a property with a non-Hong Kong PR, DSD will apply because one of the parties holds another property. Given the current ad valorem duty regime, if a name of a closely related person is added, then there is exemption from the DSD. Under the DSD, if it's a nomination or addition of name or transfer involving a closely related person, there will be exemption arrangements in place of a DSD. The old rate of the valorem tax still applies because we... And if if you own a property, then you will not get exemption. We have struck a balance between the system and the policy. We've also discussed about exchange of properties. The legal advisor mentioned last time that if it's one for a swap between a residential and a non-residential for the transfer, will get exemption. Then we give exemption of the difference of money. If the value is higher, then the equality money will have to be paid. When it involves a non-residential property, there will not be any exemption. We had a discussion and we've taken on board the point of the legal advisor. We will make revisions to make clear the application of this exemption. And these are the points raised in the last meeting. Mr. To has just arrived. But it's very confusing. Let's focus on this paper first. Perhaps I will pause here. Perhaps I will ask you to reply one by one.
Item 1, some members hope that you would, for certain units of residential buildings purchased together with car parking spaces, to settle whether or not the car parking space concerned should be exempted from AVD, and the duty rate should not exceed those of the overall transaction. That is, if the car parking space is for self-use, then it should be exempted from AVD and BSD. Am I correct? But your answer was no. Well, if that person does not have a residential property, and in that transaction instrument, he purchases a residential unit and a car parking space, which come under the same title deed, and there are other instruments to prove that these two properties, at the time of transaction, the owner had to specify a certain provision that the two had to be sold and bought at the same time, then it would be viewed as a residential property, then that instrument will, in accordance with the position of the owner, if he does not own a residential property at that time, he'll be exempted. But if the car parking space and the residential unit are not under the same lease and there are no provisions that they should be bought and sold together and can be bought and sold separately, then they'll be treated as two properties of different nature. That is, one is non-residential, one is residential. And the residential unit will be put under the latest duty rates. So to put it in simple terms, you won't consider whether or not the car parking space buyer is using the space for his own use. Right. And the duty rates will not take into consideration separation of purchase and sale. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong, first round, 4 minutes per member. Well, very simple. I think for the Bureau, we're all very busy. I think the Bureau should be more determined in its acts. For the first item, for the first issue, I understand that the Bureau did reconsider its position. But I'd like to put forth a scenario for a more in-depth study by the Bureau. In reality, some housing estates do not sell their car parking spaces at the beginning. And then after some time, after population intake of the estate, or say after a number of years, the developer of the parking spaces will then sell the parking spaces. Well, at the beginning, when I purchase the properties, I rent the parking spaces from the developer. And then later I have to consider whether or not I'll buy parking spaces as well. Otherwise, I have nowhere to park my car or cars. But from what the Bureau said, the Bureau will not consider that sort of scenarios. I hope that you can carry out a more in-depth study into that sort of scenarios. I suggest that for BSD, you should consider the scenario in which there is the same developer and same properties in situ for a first purchaser of a parking space. Then you can consider whether or not to exempt that buyer from BSD. Now, that's not against the legislative intent. This is from the standpoint of actual considerations. Well, whether it's the same lease or two separate leases, well, you can resolve that scenario whether or not it's the first purchase or sale. Now, the scenario is same developer, same property site, and then first purchase of a parking space. So if all these three conditions are satisfied, can you exempt the buyer from the BSD? I understand that you're already doing something. You're willing to consider the reality. Well, no answer is required. Please seriously consider that sort of scenarios. Because given this answer from you, other members may not find it acceptable. Mr. James To, Madam Chairman, I'd like to seek clarifications first. I'm not quite clear about the situation. Number one, if there is this new property with a developer and this purchaser purchases 18C, flat 18C, at a price of $7.2 million and then $1.2 million for a parking space, say, in a basement. All right, he chooses flat 18C and this parking space. But that the two properties are put under the same lease. That is, he buys from the developer one residential unit and one parking space, but the titles can be separated and the two properties can be bought and sold separately. But then in this particular transaction, the two are put under the same lease. Well, can you grasp his question? Well, perhaps I can answer Mr. To's question in this way. Mr. To mentions the details, but I don't want the details to confuse members. Well, after the last discussion, the Bureau went back to look at the issue and the overall design. Now, Mr. To just said that at the time of purchase, the stamp duty instrument is one single instrument to cover the residential unit and one parking space. Now, given the scenario you mentioned, the parking space and the residential unit are not under the same title deed, although they're put under the same sale and purchase instrument. For the design of the BSD, we'll consider whether or not the parking space is put under the same title deed as the residential unit. If they're held at the same time, but the two properties can be bought and sold separately, then these two properties will be considered as two different properties with different nature. Generally speaking, the parking space will be a non-residential property in the calculation of duty rates. Just now, Mr. Wong Ting Kwong and Mr. James To mentioned other details. For example, the developer, when selling the residential units and the parking spaces, specify that parking spaces have to be bought and sold at the same time and together with the residential units. For AVD, we handle residential units, non-residential units, even when they're under the same instrument. Well, there are certain instruments that specify that they must be sold and purchased. Well, what did she mean by must be bought and sold? Is it that the deposit money cannot be refunded? Well, let me cite an example. If you purchase a property at $8.4 million, including a parking space, so at the very beginning, this flat 18C is to be sold together with a parking space. Under the DMC, there is a share. Now, please bear in mind that your remarks will impact on the lawyers. All those in the legal profession, they have to understand what you mean. Well, for the property instruments, at the first sale, there's a deed to specify clearly that the residential unit is linked up with a parking space and the two cannot be separated. What do you mean by cannot be separated? Because there are these undivided shares even for the parking space. And in future, those can be separated in sell and purchase. Is it that they cannot be separated? Well, these are details. Well, in a deed of mutual covenant, covers both residential units and parking spaces, and that they have to be bought and sold together and cannot be separated, then we'll consider the parking space as part of the residential unit. Madam Chairman, it's useless for her to repeat what she has already said. We're not asking about what she has already said. Legal advisor, as far as I can understand from the remarks of the Deputy Secretary, if in the DMC of the building, the residential units are already linked up with the parking spaces, in other words, according to the DMC, you cannot sell and purchase the residential units and the parking spaces separately. Well, the government has to give me a technical answer. That is, the parking space does not have an undivided share in the building, or there is an undivided share, but according to the DMC, it cannot be sold and purchased separately. Well, you have to make this very clear. Otherwise, the frontline estate agents don't know how to brief their customers. Can you be very specific in your answer? Well, I think your legal advisor has already clarified what I said. The fundamental principle is that we have to look into the DMC. Mr. James so asked about the segregation of undivided shares under the DMC. Of course, I cannot give you a broad brush approach, but a clearer answer is that if the DMC specifies that it is the same title and under the same DMC and cannot be separated in sell and purchase, then they should be considered as one property. Legal advisor. Madam Chairman, I would like to have an answer from the government official. I'd like to listen to our legal advisor. I understand eventually we'll have to ask the government officials to answer. Well, these are all recorded. Will be it the Deputy Secretary or the Inland Revenue, we have to have an official answer from the government. Legal advisor, in a moment we can ask the government to confirm my reply. I think Mr. James To was talking about the second scenario. Whether or not a parking space enjoys an undivided share is not really a very essential issue. Because if the residential unit and the parking space have to be combined together in a sell and purchase before granting an exemption, then the undivided shares will be accorded to this combined property, that is residential unit plus parking space. Well, I think the Deputy Secretary was referring to the scenario that the residential unit and the parking space are linked up together. You cannot segregate them. But in present-day Hong Kong, this is very rare. Madam Chairman, is it that the DMC specifies that the two cannot be separated? Deputy Secretary, any response? My response is that you have to look into the DMC. If the DMC specifies that the two cannot be segregated and must be held together, then the parking space will be considered as a residential property. Mr. Chairman, my question is similar to that of Mr. Wong Teng Kwong. That is, the legislative spirit this time is to combat speculation. if a property is essential for self-use and is purchased as such, then if you tackle it in the same way as you combat speculation, then it will be different from our intention. Just now, Mr. Wong Ting Kwong said that at the beginning, the parking spaces are not sold, they can only be rented. Well, let me give you a similar example. Now, I want to buy a parking space, but then it's so expensive, I cannot buy it. Oh, you still cannot. You still can buy it, but at a higher duty rate. Oh, I know, but I cannot afford it. So you are penalizing such citizens. Because I'm not speculating, the parking space is for self-use, so I'm a user. So I'm also confused. Do you actually target the speculators, or are you targeting also the non-speculators? And if you let these people off the hook, will it impact on the property market? So you have to clarify this, otherwise there will be public resentment. The public will think that you're adopting a broad brush approach without giving people a choice. And then there's another scenario. When you buy a property, you don't have so much money, you don't want to buy the parking space, but now you have more money, you want to buy a parking space. Well, it's not always the case that the buyer can afford a parking space at the same time. And Mr. James To's point is good. Say in some housing estate with villa-type houses, the same may apply. And sometimes there are low-rise houses in the same campus as the same housing estate with high-rise blocks. So it's very difficult for us to understand what the government wants to do. That will be troublesome.
It'll be difficult for lawyers to proceed. You have to give us specific examples to illustrate. It's too easy for us to endorse it, but we will be criticized heavily for blindly endorsing it. And it's something we don't want to do. Yes, there is a clear policy objective, but we don't want to catch people who you don't want to catch. There is no sunset clause. You say that this is an exceptional measure in an exceptional time, but no one knows how long it will last. DS, would you please reply to Mr. Leung's point? I fully understand that. We have had dozens of discussions in the Bills Committee. We talk about our policy, our system. There will be actual cases, and we try to cater for as many different scenarios as possible. We have to clarify our policy. Mr. Leung's point was one about car parking spaces. It's non-residential in nature. The policy under this bill is that for non-residential property, there is a demand-side management. For non-residential properties, we have not put in exemption arrangements like residential properties. We had a discussion in relation to car parking spaces. We've had discussions in the past. We admit that it's difficult to cater for every single scenario to give exemption. We want to do it by way of principle when it comes to giving off exemptions. So when it comes to AVD on residential property with car parking spaces, we have to first clarify the principle. Members mentioned different scenarios. Say, for example, the parking space is part of the residential property. We have to find ways to deal with the situation without undermining the effectiveness of the bill. Mr. Tony Zhe, thank you. The DS mentioned about exemptions and possible abuses. Let me come back to residential property with a parking space. As far as I know, for a general title deed, if the parking space is mentioned, then it will specify that it can only be sold to the person holding the property. And as to whether it contains any shares in this DMC, it's rare that a specific parking space is tied to a particular unit. But you can only sell or buy it if you are an owner of the property in the residential unit. Of course, you have to follow the DMC. And if there is exemption, how many do we give? Because you can buy one parking space or three, but you can only they can only be sold to property owners of the residential block. There may be 20 parking spaces, and one person may buy 10 parking spaces or even all 20 of them, and then rent them out or sell them to other property owners. So if we are to give exemptions, how many do we give? If you only consider the DMC and not the land lease, then there may be more abuses. If there is no limitations on the land lease and it can be sold to an outsider, then I don't think it's appropriate to give exemptions. Mr. Wong Ting Kong asked you to consider a point. You have to take this into consideration too. If there are two contracts, one for the parking space, the other one for the residential unit, there is no sunset clause, so we don't know how long this is effective. Well, when the property is sold, the buyer may say, "I don't want the parking space." So is it the case that the buyer will have to buy both items, two title deeds, one related to the parking space, the other one to the residential unit? You have to consider that. And someone may use his residential unit to buy many parking spaces. And if there is exemption, then that person may sell them on without being charged DSD. So you have to consider whether the purchase involves both a residential unit and parking space or not. And sometimes the parking space can be separated from the residential property. So you can buy one residential property and maybe a dozen parking spaces. Please consider all these. DS, any response? No. Mr. Zhe has set out more specifics. It always boils down to our policy. For non-residential properties, there is no exemption. When we talked about parking spaces, bluntly say whether there is exemptions or not. We take into consideration the different scenarios and situations, and then we weigh up the pros and cons. In the past, when it comes to the ad valorem duty, AVD, there were similar scenarios. Of course, we should not deviate from the AVD regime. But when it comes to actual operation, there may be cases when a person buying one residential property buys a multiple of car parking spaces at the same time. We can't exclude that. And well, what if a person buys a property and the parking space, and then the next buyer buys the property and the parking space in two title deeds? The IRD will look at the two separate instruments and charge them accordingly. So the parking space in this case will not be part of the residential property. So the IRD will look at the instrument. Mr. Kenneth Leung, I'm not a lawyer for conveyancing, but I'm also responsible for conveyancing. When it comes to the same instrument, you will look at whether the car parking space can be separated from the residential property. If it is, then you consider it as a separate property. I've listened to the many scenarios set out by members. Of course, the ideal is that DMC will say Unit A comes with car parking space number 10, but that is rare. But very often, if there is a term in the DMC saying that only people who are owners of the properties in the block can buy car parking spaces, but there are many options. I've come across some cases, say, my property comes with two or three car parking spaces, but I can also buy only one or none. If there are such options, will the extra car parking spaces be considered a separate property? Because I have the option of buying zero or a multiple of car parking spaces. Can you set out in the schedule or the practice notes about the different scenarios and the corresponding arrangements? If you tell us that we will have to look at the case itself, then lawyers and other professionals will not be able to do anything. If you just tell us the principles, say the unit comes with only one car parking space and any additional ones will be treated as non-residential. You either set out the basic principle or you set out in the practice notes in detail all scenario, an exhaustive list, so that people who are in conveyancing will have something to base on, whether it is the AVD or this bill. I would like a consistent approach. Ms. Chen, you talk about closely related persons. The definition of which provision do you use? DS? Well, perhaps we will first focus on car parking space. You ask your question later. Mr. James Tian, I can only talk about car parking space and not other things. Yes, let's focus on this now. Oh, I'm not talking about car parking space. Perhaps I will wait. Mr. Shek, are you talking about car parking spaces? Yes. Perhaps you give us a class asking Lands Department to give us an explanation. There is a lease when you build a block, restricting the number of car parking spaces tied to a property unit. So the lease conditions has made it very clear. Not every unit comes, or not every block comes with parking spaces. First, there is the land's condition, and then there is the DMC terms. You did not answer Mr. James To's question, which is a very good one. It touched on Mr. Wong Ting Kwong and Mr. Leung's point. You said they are non-residential. How come? It's for the use of the residential block. You confuse us. Car parking spaces cannot be used by an outsider and cannot be sold by an sold to an outsider. There may be separate title deeds.
Perhaps you're not clear about this. Maybe you should invite a reader to come and explain to you, or the Lands Department or the Planning Department to explain to you. Then you can answer their questions in one go. This is a very real issue. Otherwise, the lawyers won't know what to do. If this is not clarified, numerous litigations may result. So, Madam Chairman, we have to clarify the aim of the policy. Well, the aim of the policy is clear to us, but the point is, how are you going to allow the policy objective to operate? Deputy Secretary, Madam Chairman, I'll listen to members first. All right, second round on parking spaces. Mr. James To. Oh, Mr. Andrew Leung, sorry. Well, on parking spaces, the most important point is that it actually doesn't matter what you do with parking spaces. But this doubled AVD has led to problems. Some people buy more than one parking spaces in one go. So you have to look at this real scenario. Well, we have so many members here, they can present you with 100 cases and ask you how to handle them. I think the main point is not to disturb those who are properly engaged in property transactions. Well, Mr. Wong Ting Kwong asked about the leases. Oh, yes, the leases can look very good nowadays. But 50 years ago, that's not the case. The flat in which I lived in the 1960s, the lease terms, lease conditions were not so clear. The parking spaces were not so clear in terms of status. So if you now say that certain things cannot be done, there'll be problems. Of course, now the leases are very modernized. But then, you see, 50 years ago, we also had parking spaces, but the lease conditions were not so clear. So there is a difficulty here. But you yourselves created the difficulty. You are now proposing a double stamp duty, and you would like to add in the non-residential properties. If you follow the advice of the BPU and adopt the criterion of self-use, then there won't be any problem at all. Mr. James To, Madam Chairman, Mr. Andrew Leung repeated the fundamental principle. I think the government and members, including Mr. Tony Dare, have to consider that fundamental principle. If you are buying a residential property for the first time, then you don't need to pay the doubled AVD. That's the basic principle. Now, for this person buying a residential property for the first time, Well, if he wants to buy a parking space, which at the moment is a semi-luxury commodity, well, some people may not agree, but maybe that person really needs a car. So be it an old building or a new building, if he wants to add a parking space to the transaction, if the DMC allows him to do so, on the basis of the parking space being a separate property, well, I think 99% of the cases will be in this category. Last time you told us that if that is to be the case, the whole transaction will be considered as a transaction of non-residential property transaction. That means the parking space. So originally, the person just wants to buy a residential unit, but given the cutoff threshold at $6 million to $7 million, that person now has to pay much more. And then Mr. Wong Ting Kwong reminded me, well, it's very simple. You buy the residential unit for the first time first. Well, but if you don't buy the parking space at the beginning, later, you may not be able to buy one. Now, Mr. Wong Ting Kwong asked you to consider granting exemption to the situation in which the person purchases the residential unit for the first time and he'd like to add a parking space to that transaction. So he wants that to be put under exemption. So that's so simple. Other colleagues may say, what if that person buys one residential unit plus 30 parking spaces? But we're not talking about that sort of scenario. You're talking about one lease. Well, say if a person buys 50 Tai Ku Shing residential units under one instrument, that of course is different. So you are creating obstacles for yourselves. You say you have to take into consideration the original feature and property of the property. Well, if the person buys 50 Tai Ku Shing flats in one transaction, then that person will not have to pay doubled AVD either. Well, behind you, you have the bureaucrats. Well, this is easy for the bureaucrats, but for policy making, you have to follow the spirit. That is, what sort of policies you want to implement. Otherwise, there will be a great deal of public resentment in society. When I first heard Mr. Wong Ting Kwong's proposal that the first parking space should be exempted, I had certain doubts. But after listening to members' views, I believe Mr. Wong Ting Kwong's suggestion makes sense. So please think about that. In a moment, I'll give you another example. Well, there may be huge problems as well. So maybe you should respond to this particular scenario first. Deputy Secretary, well, when we listen to members' views, we always take members' views back for consideration. Oh, Mr. Andrew Leung is away from the room. At the moment, we're treating a parking space as a non-residential property. So given the design of the policy, overall speaking, we have to manage the demand for residential properties. If a person purchases a residential unit together with a parking space, or he buys the parking space later for self-use, the factors of consideration I set out for parking spaces do not result just from the BSD and doubled AVD. Even for enhanced SSD, we have the same consideration because we target residential properties. So for parking spaces, we have to be consistent in our policies. So if we are to deliberate on parking spaces to see whether or not we should have special arrangements for parking spaces, then we have to look at BSD and doubled AVD. Again, Well, if a parking space is not held together with a residential unit, then it's a non-residential property and would be subject to BSD and double DVD. So we really have to have consistency. Therefore, we have to be very careful. We have to look into this seriously. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong, Madam Chairman, I hope that the Bureau would not be so rigid in its way of thinking. Well, for the Stamp Duty Amendment Bills 2012 and 2013, the legislative intent is very clear. We don't want to suffocate the property market. We just want to guard against property speculation. Is that correct? Well, you insist that a parking space is a non-residential property. We don't want to disturb the public. For the general public, they are most concerned about clothing, food, accommodation, and transport. So, please note what I just said. For this amendment bill, there are three fundamental conditions. Same developer, same residential area, and first purchase of a parking space. First, given my personal experience, well, in the 1970s, I bought a residential property with a parking space combined. In the 1980s, I had children. I needed a bigger residential unit, so I sold the first property. But then the buyer did not have enough money to buy the parking space. He asked to buy the residential unit only, with the parking space separated. Under the lease, the two can be separated, so I only sold the residential unit and kept the parking space for leasing up to now. Now, if the buyer wants to buy the parking space also, can he do so? Well, the estate agent then told me that in that building, many residential unit owners did not have parking spaces, so I could sell my parking space later. So that's the scenario back then. Well, now, of course, I won't sell because the buyer will have to pay double DVD. So I'm not saying this for my personal interest. I'm just telling you actual scenarios. We do have an objective with this bill. We don't want to disturb the public. So we're really sincere. Please do not be so rigid in your thinking. Don't just embrace residential units and tell us the parking spaces are not residential properties. Sometimes parking spaces may affect people's livelihood. Well, you mentioned stringent requirements for advertisements, etc., etc. Well, Mr. Leung Chi Cheung, have you ever noticed that for some freestanding houses in the new territories, they have double parking spaces? So many people, when they buy these properties, buy two parking spaces because they have more than one car. So you see, when you legislate, you have to consider different scenarios. So you have to be comprehensive in your deliberation. Any more members who would like to speak? Mr. Tony De speaking for the second time. Madam Chairman, just now I was only asking the administration to consider certain scenarios. Well, parking space is a consideration, but as Mr. James So mentioned, if the residential unit and the parking space are put under one instrument, as the price is higher, it will affect the duty rates. Well, unless you're talking about a very valuable parking space, then you can separate the parking space from the residential unit and with a separate instrument. Then the residential unit may fetch a lower duty rate. But then after considering the double AVD, you may think it's better to separate the two. Otherwise, you may have to pay 4.75 or even higher. Well, these are actual choices. And then we also have the problem mentioned by Mr. Wong Ting Kwong. Of course, we're not thinking of the tax evasors. Well, sometimes people are just doing tax planning. They don't intend to evade tax. So please consider this very seriously. After all, these are technical and complicated issues. Well, some people may want to separate the deeds for the two, which may attract different duty rates. And of course, they will consider the three duty rates, the double AVD, BSD, and enhanced SSD. Anyway, we have to be very careful, and we have to deliberate in detail. Mr. James To, third round. Madam Chairman, well, if you say that the DMC does not allow the two to be bought and sold separately, then I'm saying that you are just trying to disturb the public just because of this. Well, say if a person wants to buy 100 parking spaces for leasing, so he may buy flat 18C plus 100 parking spaces. But the DMC provides that the whole batch, that is 100 parking space plus the residential unit, have to be bought and sold together. Some properties in Aga Street and Sauls Avenue are under that sort of scenario. So, if you insist on that, in future, you may have difficulties and people may rebuke you. Now, I won't repeat what I've already said. Well, one instrument for first-time buyer of one Tai Ku Sheng flat plus 100 parking spaces. If you say no double AVD has to be paid, then I really have to protest. If you just claim that there is this feature in the DMC, I won't agree. You really have to be flexible in this scenario. So Deputy Secretary, please go back and consider this.
If we can achieve our policy objective, then we don't want to miss that. We want to improve it as much as we can. For paragraph 3, what you want to achieve is that for residential and non-residential, and if there are many different exemption arrangements, then the IRD will have to make a decision depending on the various different situations. I have doubts. If the residential is several million and the non-residential is tens of million, if it's a residential plus a storeroom on the ground floor, and the DMC and the OP allows the storeroom on the ground floor to be run as a shop, and altogether the two properties are purchased at $78 million, then you won't be able to charge them DSD, and then you are taken advantage. Considering everything you have said, you will be used against you. You create nuisance for people buying a residential unit with a parking space. But at the same time, you create a loophole for people buying a residential with a non-residential property. So that is very dangerous. Yes, your views are noted. And I think for non-residential properties and parking space, there is a fundamental difference. I've heard from a number of legislators their views on parking spaces. Let me sum up our view. If there is housing need, we will not not do it simply because it's complicated. It's not our intention to create nuisance. But when it comes to the law, there should be clear definition and objective definition. The fact that there are many different scenarios should not result in giving an exhaustive list. We should give general objective principles. The Lands Department, the Planning Department, and us all understand the situation involving parking spaces. We have to look at the facts of the case, the DMC and the land's condition. We cannot give an exhaustive list of the many different scenarios. If it can be dealt with under the existing legislations, it will be dealt with by legislation. And there are cases in the past when it's dealt with by practice notes. And if it's necessary, we will do that. If it's a general situation, and if there is a need to cater for that, we will consider to make a provision for it. All I can say is that it is not easy, but we will continue to look into it, and we will revert to you. We aim at bringing in improvements on the operability of the law. So one instrument is buying more than one property and also the arrangements for replacement properties. Mr. James Tian. I have my views on parking space and the many different issues. The other two, stamp duty bills, have been endorsed. This particular bill, does it achieve policy objective? I doubt it. We're talking about an increase from over 4% to 8%. Is to be paid to public coffer for people who have already owned properties. In a way that this doesn't target speculators, because buyers, sellers and buyers both buy and sold at a higher price. Mainlanders have a very strong views about it. You impose 10% on them when they come to Hong Kong to buy properties. But if Hong Kong people go to buy properties on the mainland, there is no higher rate. Yes, indeed, there is a drop in transaction from mainlanders. I have a declaration to make. I'm involved in real estate in some way. The mainlanders say that it's not that they can't afford it. They buy properties in New York, in London. Now, you don't welcome them, just like mainland visitors. And if you don't welcome them, they go somewhere else. If you don't welcome us to buy properties here, we will go to London. Then you see that our market will shrink. There is a significant shrink in the second-hand property market. developers don't lose out. They just buy things. Well, if they buy in cheap, they will sell cheap. If they buy in costly, they will too. Like Kai Tak properties, the price has dropped from 7,000 to 5,000, and the government took it back. And now developers give back the extra duties to buyers. Land prices might have dropped, but developers use the amount they have saved from land prices to give back to buyers. Property prices are still high. Well, yes, they have dropped, but buyers and sellers, buyers will still have to pay just as much. They have to pay over 8% in duty. So it hurts the middle class, it hurts the real estate agents. Developers continue to benefit because with property prices dropping, then land prices will drop, and they can buy land cheaper. So a simple question. We have about 1,000 units under the Hong Kong property for Hong Kong people. And now no one knows about the way forward. And we've spent a lot of time on this bill. If it will only last for a year or so, you might as well withdraw it. If it's in place for just a year or two, how are you going to end it in the future? I remember in the first 10 meetings or so, we have had discussions about the policy intent and also the policy itself. We're now in clause by clause. I will just give a brief reply to Mr. Tian's questions. The various duties, including SSD and also the BSD, which was launched in 2012, and the DSD, which is launched in February 2013, they target different buyers in different markets. So they are all demand side management. We see that in year 2012, there is a drop in property prices. The market is not as heated. We think that there is a need for the series of demand-side management measures. In relation to the AVD and the DSD, we think there is a need to implement it as soon as possible. In recent Bills Committee meeting, we went through the clause by clause. We aim at improving the clauses so that the public will find it easier to understand. There is a need to implement the measures as soon as possible so that we can make a swift responses to the changes in the market. We have completed the first round. Now, Mr. James To, it's a 4(3). You said that we do not rule out possibilities that when Hong Kong PRs not owning any other properties will use one single instrument to buy a multiple of properties. As a result, that this is a consistent way to deal with it. The same treatment applies, it says. Well, you say if the person doesn't own any property, then there is no need for them to pay DSD. That's right. What if that same person buys 50 properties? Should exemptions be given? Does it mean that that person has 50 families to house? You want to combat speculative activities. Well, you said above it that charging stamp duty on an instrument basis is an inherent feature under SDO. If a first time buyer buys 50 properties in Taikoo-shing, why can't you charge him the SD? It can be done. Why do you insist on the exemption? The public will be furious, and they will doubt you that you are actually opening the gate for a certain group of people. And to whom? Well, you said that you will stick to the existing practice. Yes. Thank you, Mr. To, for his question again. This involves the principle and the regime of the AVD. Well, whether it is BSD, DSD, or SSD, they are all based on an instrument. For under DSD, the stamp duty is doubled. When the IRD charges stamp duty on an instrument, they will look at the total consideration on the instrument. There is no distinction as to how many properties are involved.
Secondly, when we designed this policy of doubled AVD in October 2012, when we had the BSD and the enhanced SSD, we had new measures to tackle speculation and to manage the demand of first-time HKPR buyers. If at present a person holds some properties and during this new purchase that person holds properties, a double stamp duty would be charged. So this is for a person who already owns properties at the time of the transaction. Otherwise, the old duty rates would be adopted. Last time, some members were concerned about a scenario. If a person uses an instrument to buy more than one property, he may be engaged in speculation. Well, we understand that possible scenario, but we have to consider the overall regime. This proposed doubled AVD is a special measure during special times. That is to double the original AVD. Therefore, in the transaction instrument, we won't, in relation to multi-property purchases, set further restrictions. We have to consider the core and fundamental principle of the stamp duty regime. Madam Chairman, even the most tolerant and patient person will get annoyed. Well, for a person who does not own a property but now wants to buy 50 properties in one go, he is exempted from the double AVD. But if a person already has a residential unit and wants to buy a parking space, he has to pay double AVD. Well, Mr. To, we have to clarify whether this is technically feasible at all. Listen to more members. Mr. Abraham Sheikh, Madam Chairman, we should not confuse the whole issue. In 2012, when we had the SSD, the stipulation is that there is a time frame, 3 months, 12 months, 18 months, etc. And then for BSD in 2012, that's to protect Hong Kong PRs, to protect their home ownership rights. We don't want non-HKPRs to interfere with our market. That's the BSD in 2012. But for the doubled AVD in 2013, members clarified that the original intent was to target speculation, to combat speculation. But then the coverage of the government's proposal is rather broad. Many Hong Kong PLs will be affected as a result, whether or not they are buying for investment or otherwise. So the three stamp duties are different, their nature are different, the duty rates are also different. I think just now the Deputy Secretary was mentioning something not within her portfolio. She mentioned something under Professor Anthony Leung's portfolio. Mr. To was correct. If a person wants to buy a residential property plus 100 parking spaces, the duty rate is 4.25%. But then, in Mr. Wong Ting Kwong's example, if that person bought a residential unit in the past and now wants to buy a car parking space, he has to pay 8.5%. So the logic is not correct. You have to be clear about the legislative intent of the 2012 bill and that of the 2013 bill. So don't repeat the 2012 regime. Otherwise, members would be very angry. You see, in future history, will show that we had been trapped, so to speak, back then in 2012. I think Mr. To had clearly brought out the basic principle. I think you really have to go back and deliberate on that. Otherwise, in future, our transactions will be very complicated and Hong Kong will become a mess. You won't be able to bear that sort of responsibilities. Any response? No? Mr. Andrew Leung, then? Madam Chairman, I of course support Mr. Abraham Sheikh's views. They cannot mess up everything and treat everything the same. In fact, we're talking about different policies. I very much love that remark of the Deputy Secretary. That is special measures at special times. Then she should accept my proposal for a sunset clause. Well, if it is 2 years, then 2 years. We work within 2 years. Otherwise, we won't know whether these special measures at special times will end. Well, they may just be cheating us for the time being by mentioning these special measures at special times or extraordinary measures at extraordinary times. I think any law has to be fair and just. You see, people always say that if a person buys one more property, he has to pay double stamp duty. But if a very rich person buys 100 or 50 properties, he's exempted. So if we are to pass a piece of legislation that the public do not believe to be fair and just, then we'll be held liable. So, Deputy Secretary, we have a basic concept for stamp duties, but you are now telling us that you are talking about a special measure at a special time, an extraordinary measure at an extraordinary time. So don't go back to the old regime, the routine regime. Ad valorem duty and stamp duties are within Hong Kong's permanent infrastructure. In 2012, we ended up with a big laughing stock. So for this 2013 bill, I don't want to end up with another laughing stock. So I don't want the Deputy Secretary and the Bureau Director to come up with an absurd piece of legislation like last time. So we're being sincere. Deputy Secretary, any response? Yes, let me respond, Madam Chairman. I mentioned SSD and BSD just now because I'd like to give members the background of the whole regime. That is, we have different policies to target different issues. for this double DVD. It's an extraordinary measure based on the AVD. All along, the AVD regime is spirit and principle is that we adopt an instrument basis in charging AVD. So we use the overall consideration as the basis. So we've taken into consideration that principle and design. Then we proceeded to see how we can attain our legislative or policy objective. Our policy objective is to manage the purchase of residential properties. We have to take into consideration the demands. So that's why we'd like to attain our policy objective by way of such a design. I understand that members have been actively and positively assisting the administration in its deliberation. They asked whether we're deviating from the original policy. That is, by way of one instrument, a person may be buying more than one property. But the whole design is to base on the original regime. Just now, some members asked whether or not we could consider special restrictions or special provisions such that the transaction instrument, if involving different properties, will have to attain our policy objective by way of certain restrictions. Let me point out that technically we can always overcome difficulties, but in practice, in reality, we have to consider that a person may need to use one single instrument to buy more than one property. So how are we going to determine the number of properties involved in imposing this new stamp duty? So on balance, when we designed the regime, we considered that when a person already holds a property, a residential property, we don't want that person to enter the market at this juncture, so to speak. And we don't want to interfere with the existing basis of the AVD regime, that is instrument-based basis. Well, Mr. Andrew Lang, Madam Chairman, I have to declare what I previously declared. I forgot to do so just now. There are two issues here. In the 2012 bill, the administration gave up almost all principles. The government just wanted to increase or decrease stamp duties as it so wishes. So not your bureau, but your neighboring bureau has already given up that principle. Well, just now we're talking about parking space plus residential unit. You evaded the issue, and now we asked whether any exemption can be granted to the first-time buyer. Well, you can draft your bill properly. Say, you can say in your bill that if you buy 50 properties in one go, you won't be exempted. Well, we're talking about the same thing, but you say sometimes the person will be exempted, sometimes he won't be exempted. You see, members are not schizophrenic. We cannot accept double principles or double standards from you. Mr. Porter has not spoken yet. I have to give the floor to him. Madam Chairman, about declaration, theoretically, the legislation we're discussing is already underway. Well, people may ask when they buy more than one property whether they should use one instrument or more than one instrument. When we discussed the double stamp duty, we mentioned the use of declarations to serve as evidence for interest. Well, you did not approve that suggestion, saying that that's subject to abuse. But later you asked people to submit declarations as a rectification or remedy. So that's not ideal. The policy, the regime is already underway, and you still say that you want to listen to members' views. Of course, you sounded friendly, saying that you want to listen to us. But this amendment bill will affect the public. Well, you're adopting extraordinary measures. You always mention extraordinary measures at extraordinary times. But we would like to clarify that there's not going to be retrospectivity. What about number five? You shouldn't interfere with the market. You disregarded that. I totally agree with Mr. James So. You have to consider parking spaces. You mentioned balance, you mentioned probabilities. Well, what's the probability of a Hong Kong PR buying a residential unit or a parking space? Well, you don't deliberate on the concerns of the public. Instead, you create obstacles for yourselves. Well, you always say that you implement what's mature. That's totally absurd. Things keep happening minute after minute. You must handle them. Deputy Secretary, Madam Chairman, we're scrutinizing this bill. The IRD cannot impose a doubled AVD yet. But if I'm a buyer, should I use one instrument or two? This is happening day after day. Madam Chairman, the design of the doubled AVD is based on the existing AVD regime. That is instrument-based. That is instrument basis. We're adopting an instrument basis. Well, Madam Chairman, the Deputy Secretary should tell Hong Kong people whether they should use one instrument, two instruments, three instruments, or whatnot. These are happening day after day. If they get wrong, they may be sued. Deputy Secretary, for the whole design, the government has no intention to, in terms of design, set extra restrictions and impose special arrangements for the established regime. We can tell buyers and members here. So, as for past examples, like the purchase of parking spaces, that's quite another issue. It has nothing to do with the instrument basis regime.
If we are to make different arrangements for different scenarios, well, then they will be set out in the legislation, and the IRD will act accordingly. But this is negative. But this is already effective. So, how are they supposed to do it? One title deed or two? No, we are scrutinizing the bill. It's not that it's implemented before we scrutinize it. We have announced the tax ban, but when it comes to the power to collect stamp duty, well, DS, I think you have to ask about it. Stamp duties have already been collected, so it is effective. Well, do you have anyone to explain? I will defer to the IRD. Yes, you understand the operation in the market. Yes, the market. But we don't know what is happening. You can't backdate the instrument depending on what happens next. Legal advisor, please tell us how you understand it. Yes, we're scrutinizing the bill, and the bill is yet to become an ordinance. But all the transactions taking place now are bound by the bill. So the public do not know clearly about the law. As a result, it's difficult for them to make an informed decision. So everything we say, all the decisions we make, will affect the decisions of the public. Mr. Lam Tai Fai, I have to declare interest. Well, I also have to declare that my interest has been undermined. Just a month ago, in Yang Yat-chun, I wanted to buy a flat. We've negotiated on the price as well. It comes with a parking space. And I asked for separate title deeds. Well, you know, I won't put everything on hold simply because there is conflict of interest. Well, I said, I want a valuation from the bank. Tony Dare teased me. He asked me to evaluate for him. Of course, I wouldn't do that. There is a delay. And the seller thought that I was making trouble because I asked for separate title deed. And as a result, I couldn't buy the flat. I don't know whether it will turn out to be good or not, but I'm not happy because I couldn't buy it. And there is another transaction at the end of April. It's non-residential. Do I have to pay stamp duty? I still have to pay. I pay to my lawyer. I have to pay it. It's only to the lawyer for the time being. And I think the market is completely messed up by you. If I want to take a loan from the bank, I don't know how much I should take because I don't know how much stamp duty I'm going to pay. It really is the nuisance. James Tian has put it correctly. The policy itself is wrong. It doesn't help the public buy their own property. Yes, it combats speculative activities. This bill involves a non-residential. You're actually chasing investors away from Hong Kong. Yes. Well, you don't have to admit openly that you've made a mistake in order not to lose face, but you have to remedy your mistakes. Now, people can't buy flats, can't buy a home, you can't find land. And you couldn't explain clearly to us about buying 50 properties in one single instrument. The logic is wrong. We don't understand. Why can't you amend it? It's meaningless for us to get bogged down by it because everyone has mentioned this. DS, I'd like to clarify that the design of the DSD is premised on the AVD. So when it is announced, from the time when it was announced to the introduction of the bill, the design itself is clear. If we put in additional restrictions, simply because there is a multiple of properties in the instrument, then it has changed the basic design. We have to be very careful. Mr. Kenneth Leung, I don't think there is any core problem. This is not Hong Kong's core value. To be pragmatic, this bill has retrospective effect. Of course, if it's not endorsed, then nothing happens. But once it's endorsed, it has retrospective effect. You will collect stamp duty. Well, unless you can tell us that, from now till when the bill is endorsed, everything is exempted, whether it is one property or 50 properties. But you say you can't do that. How about this? If you want to get exemption, from the date when it's gazetted, you can only get exemption for one property. And for the property that you want to get exemption, it has to be a separate title deed. It may be different. It may be a different piece of legislation, but it's an easier task. Just separate it. Everything can be done. You don't abide by rules anyway. Yes, DSD, BSD, SSD, in your eyes, are the same thing. But they tackle different problems. If you send out an unclear message to the market, you may as well think about whether to do it. There is an IMF report the day before yesterday asking you not to do it. I'm not saying that combating speculative activity is wrong. The principle itself is right. We have to pay hundreds of thousands of dollars just to give advice. And you have to pay hundreds of thousands of dollars just to get advice or legal cost. It's not worth it, DS. We have repeatedly explained about the legislative effect. We still think that the demand-side management measures are necessary, and they target different markets, and we will give priority to housing needs of Hong Kong PR. We have a very animated discussion to improve the bill. We will listen to members' views. We will continue to consider the exemptions and restrictions proposed by members. We'll continue to interact with members. And as to whether we will consider, for the sake of DSD, put in additional restrictions on a single instrument involving a multiple of properties, this will be harsher. We're talking about different groups. We have to be very careful as to whether we need to impose further restrictions or limitations. We've carefully set out our reasons. We don't have the intention to impose such restrictions, but we will continue to consider it. On parking space, we will continue to consider it. You have to carefully consider the consideration of the bill. This is the 12th meeting. We have spent considerable time on policy. We ask the administration to improve the content set out, the points set out in CB(1)(1219/13/14)(02). I asked the administration to consider it. Mr. To, the DS talks about demand-side management. Then why don't you exercise the same demand-side management where it involves about 50 properties in one single instrument? The public will not listen to you when you talk about one single property. People only talk about how many properties are involved. So there is no need for demand-side management if for the first instrument it covers 50 properties, but there is a need for demand-side management where it comes to the second instrument involving one property. Mr. James Tian. If you're a loyalist, of course, you want to help the government in the implementation of policies. But I'm of two minds. I may be a loyalist, but from time to time, I don't completely agree with the administration. Well, I engage in real estate. Members talk about many cases, but the opposing side is always a few steps ahead of you. It's just like the previous bills. The government refused to listen to us. Consequences. The consequence will be dire. When will it happen? Maybe it's after 2017. But people still know who is the chief executive when the bill was endorsed. We want a bill that is enforceable and accepted by the market. I think that there will be a lot of pieces to be picked up even when the bill is endorsed.
Well, if they have these views and you totally reject them, then back in the minds of our members, be they the pro-establishment camp or the pan-democrats that oppose the government, only the Liberal Party and Mr. Abraham Sheikh are exemptions. You see, some of the members are not here. Well, some of them may support the government. I think the government has enough votes to get this bill passed. But as a result, the government may become arrogant. There will be votes from the pro-establishment camps and from some of the pan-democrats like Mr. James To. Now, you shouldn't have that mentality, because in future, when the bill is implemented and we have great confusion and chaos, all the blame will be put on the CE. Now, if you can handle the outstanding issues properly and the Liberal Party can support you, good suggestions from members are adopted, such that in future the bill can be smoothly implemented, then it would be even better for you. So, Madam Chairman, I'm undecided yet. Should this bill be passed with concessions from the government or without? We'll wait till the third reading of the bill. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong, Madam Chairman, both you and I belong to the DAB. You see, we are the genuine and real pro-establishment members. However, on this bill, we shouldn't create conflicts between the pro-establishment camp and the pan-democrats. I think on livelihood issues, we always share a common view. Now, logically, the legislative intent of this bill is in contradiction with the government's policies. I think we've all said what we would like to say. I'm really very saddened. Mr. James Tian even mentioned that the ultimate consequence may have to be borne by the CE. Well, are these members obstinate, or the Bureau being obstinate, or the CE being obstinate? It's not necessary for us to continue like this. Well, I think the DAB has to consider this. If something is illogical, then it's not a question of whether or not you are from the pro-establishment camp. It's now a question of whether or not you should blindly follow somebody. I'm afraid that public resentment may result. Deputy Secretary, I'm really worried. If we really result in public resentment, it won't be good to the government. It won't be good to the scrutinizing members here either, including the PAN Democrats. People will ask, what are you doing as councillors? So please don't be too obstinate. I'm really sincere. I am not even so patient and sincere with my children. Deputy Secretary, the legislative intent of the 2012 bill was acceptable to the general public. Well, let's not talk about the details. We've discussed them already. But for the 2013 bill, right from day one, I told you it's controversial. You'd like to combat speculation. You would like to extend the coverage to non-residential units. In 2012, we had learned a lesson. We did not consider certain possible scenarios. Well, some problems have emerged for TPS. I was already very unhappy. Now, this amendment bill is so controversial. Some members have put forth suggestions to solve the problem. Well, I think parking spaces are fundamentally different from non-residential properties. Well, for the time being, you may say that there are not that many people caught. But given such a broad discussion, we discovered that there are bound to be such cases. So given the legislative intent, it will be very difficult for you to convince members to support you. So please do not insist on your existing explanation of your position. It's not acceptable to members. Last time we already advise you very sincerely. I understand that in terms of implementation, you have difficulties. You have to convince different levels of people. But from my observation, it will be very difficult for you to canvass supportive votes in the LegCo. So please go back and think about this. Sorry, the speaker is not coming through. Well, when the time comes, well, we have negative vetting, etc., etc. Well, Madam Chairman, this is an opportune time for us to discuss the issue. It's already too late. Well, Madam Chairman, we've been discussing this for a prolonged period of time. Yes, it's not negative vetting, as I said, but in actual fact, the bill or the provisions in the bill had already been implemented. Well, bid officials, the legal profession, users or speculators, they need to know the clear picture. A lot of work is pending. Well, think of possible filibustering. In the budget debate, we'll have filibustering. If we also have filibustering for this bill, well, I really don't know how many more filibustering exercises we would have. Mr. Tony Dare, well, may I go back to the responding paper, that is 1219-02. They say that the doubled AVD measures are based on the existing AVD regime. We understand that. But we have to understand the overall objective of the bill. The government said is to cool down the property market, to reduce speculation, and to increase the cost of sell and purchase because you are doubling the AVD. So that's the basis of the exercise. So this will be different from the original AVD regime. Before the doubling of AVD, you can use one instrument to cover, say, 10 properties. You pay the same stamp duty because the duty rates were the same. You just pay the cumulative duty rates. But now, given the doubled AVD regime, there's an exemption provision. We want to manage demands. We want to give priority to Hong Kong PRs. So why buy dozens of properties? Of course, it's for speculation. So if you do not impose the double DVD on such a transaction, you'll be going against your fundamental principle of combating speculation and managing demands. If your strategy differs from your objective, there is a problem. You have to think about it. For the ordinary public, they won't find it all right. They will query, oh, why buy dozens of properties? Is it really for self-use? So this is really a huge problem. The government needs to think about this because it's going against your objective. Are you trying to facilitate speculation? Oh, you tell us to disregard AVD. Of course, in the past, the duty rates were the same. In the past, transactions were like that. Dr. Lam Tai Fai told you why there should be separate instruments, because after calculation, that may result in a benefit. But if you still offer that benefit, people will ask why a buyer has to buy dozens of properties. Is it for speculation? So, DS, you have to go back and think about this. Well, you need not go against your original objective. You can amend the objective. Oh, you can support me, I mean our members. So the government should not insist on harping on old tunes or following on old footpaths. Well, if the objective is good, the government has to do it. I think the bureau director should come personally to explain to us. Mr. Paul Zhe, Madam Chairman, just a few days ago, I noted a case in which a small law firm was sued. 90% of our law firms are small law firms. The mother supported the daughter in the purchase of a property. Is it a loan, a gift, or whatnot? That's not mentioned, but eventually that resulted in an actual benefit. Now the litigation is going on. Now, if a citizen comes forth and asks you, if he wants to buy two properties, what's the proper way to go about it, one instrument or two, which will benefit him more? And if a person wants to buy a parking space, he will come forward to ask you whether he should use one instrument or two. Well, people will ask you these questions. It's just like the baby formula restriction. We had negative vetting, and then later somebody was imprisoned, innocent person being imprisoned. Well, they say they adopt extraordinary measures at extraordinary times, but every regime has its own history and background. Same with the baby formula restriction, pricing, etc. We had to understand the consequences. Now, you say this is a special measure, but this double DVD will affect the whole structure. Mr. Tony Jay was correct. You're talking about a double AVD. So how are you going to answer public queries? One wants to buy two properties, two residential units. One wants to buy a parking space. Deputy Secretary, Mr. Paul Jay and Mr. Tony Jay have asked questions. I'll try to be brief. Mr. Tony Jay asked us to go back and deliberate on that. We'll of course do so. This is a major issue which will impact on the tax regime and the principle behind the levy of the double DVD. So if we want to effect any change or adjustment, we have to consider feasibility. That is, whether or not we can implement the strategy. And we have to consider the controversy surrounding a strategy. Now, this is a major controversy because we're talking about day-to-day transaction instruments. So we have to be very careful. As for Mr. Baudet's remarks, of course, I have to add that although I said that the IRD had not started to impose or charge the double AVD, the proposed tax bans and doubled AVD would serve as a basis for transactions. At present, the general public will use that as a basis of consideration when they decide whether or not to buy properties. Ever since the introduction of the amendment bill, we've maintained the ad valorem duty regime. That's our fundamental principle. As for parking spaces and additional residential units, we'll go back and look into all those issues. In the Bureau, we've always looked into these issues very carefully. If members have any invaluable advice for us, we'll definitely consider them. And then we'll have to consider whether social chaos or confusion may result. Madam Chairman, given what the Deputy Secretary said, no matter how they change their proposals, something will go wrong. People will suffer either way. Mr. Wong Ting Kong, well, the Deputy Secretary mentioned so frequently the term instrument. Did she mean the sale and purchase agreement or the land lease? Or the sales arrangements of the developer?
For sales and purchase agreement, it can be about a lot of things. You can have one single agreement covering many properties, one single agreement covering residential property with parking space. So when you say instrument, does it mean just the agreement? Or does it include the assignments of the title deed as well? Because maybe if residential unit and a parking space, there can be two title deeds. If I buy 50 properties, it can be 50 title deeds. If the instrument refers to title deeds, then if you buy 50 properties, then there will be 50 instruments. If I buy one old building, and it's one single title deed and one single instrument. For new developments, it may be about the price list of a certain unit. Is it the instrument? I want a clarification from the administration. What do you mean by instrument? Please be brief. It's stipulated in the bill. It is the immovable property, the instrument related to the transaction of the immovable property that is chargeable. It can be the assignment and it can be the sale and purchase agreement. Sorry, speaker's not coming through. So it's not the title deed. Say the SNP agreement or the assignment. And it's a major loophole. The agreement can cover the entire earth or more than one property because it's an agreement. I think the administration is very clear of our views. We have gone past the scheduled finishing time. The next meeting is the 25th. We asked the administration to consider all the views. We haven't even covered the other document. Well, we still have one response paper not discussed. Mr. Tony Tse and a number of members have asked questions about exchange of properties. We're asked to do some technical analysis. We will give it during the clause by clause in the next meeting. More meetings? Well, maybe we will liaise with the Secretariat. Please ask the administration to consider my proposal about the car parking space. Thank you.